can you give me a microphone and that don't matter? Today we're going to be in second chapter of John. I'm going to pray before we start. So if you can bow your head when I go to prayer. Dear Lord, I pray for our country today, Lord. I pray that with this virus going around, that people would realize they need you. Lord, everybody worried about getting the virus, they ought to be worried about accepting you, because that's a real need. Be with our leaders in this nation, Lord. Lord, I pray for Trump every day. And Lord, I pray that they make wise decisions. Lord, we need somebody to take, to bring you back into this, Lord. Lord, I pray that America will realize we've drifted so far from you. We're killing babies, and we need to honor you, Lord. Lord, bless our nation. Lord, as I speak today, Lord, I pray that you give me the ability and the wisdom to be able to speak. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Like I said, today we're going to be in the second chapter of John. I want to welcome all you all to be here, and I'm thankful for the technology to be able to do this. But in the second chapter of John, it says, in the third day was a marriage in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Man, I tell you what, I've gotten so much out of this. The third day, when you look back in Genesis, God created. You know, everybody nowadays gets married on Friday night or Saturday, where the family can all be there. But in that time, according to Jewish customs, they would get married on the third day. We would think it would be Wednesday, but it was Tuesday, because the first day was Sunday, and the second day was Monday, and then Tuesday. The reason was, you go back in Genesis, on the third day, God said it is good. But you go back in Genesis, in the word says, talks about creation. God said it is good two different times on the third day. And they thought they got married on the third day, that would be a blessing, a double blessing. So people got married on the third day of the week. Both Jesus and all his disciples were called to be there. You got to remember back in Bible times, when they had a wedding, it lasted for 7 days. They would come there, and the groom was responsible for all the drinks and all the food to feed people for 7 days. You gotta understand, it was a real dishonor to him if can provide for the wine and the food for 7 days. Everybody would go there. They wouldn't run down the street and go to Mr. Quick or something. They had to be right there. Well, it says, and when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus, said unto him, they have no wine. And Jesus said unto her, woman, what do I have to do with thee? My hour is not come. It kind of sounds confusing, but what Jesus was saying, he knew that once he started, that his day of dying on the cross was gonna be happening. He was announcing when he turned that water into wine. See, you gotta understand, this was his first miracle. And he knew when he turned the water into wine that the word was gonna be out, everybody was gonna be talking. And it was kind of like announcing his ministry. I tell you what, for years I went knowing this story, I've read it all my life. I thought, man, what a useless miracle Jesus did, turn the water into wine. But it turned out it was a powerful thing, because what he was saying is, like Jesus sung that song today, the tomb wasn't empty. We all think that the stone was rolled away so that Jesus could get out of the tomb. But the truth of the story is, the stone was rolled away so we could get in. Because Christ had done been out of the tomb. He done went. And you know, when he died on the cross, one of the guys on the cross accepted Christ as Savior. I love this story because it was such a powerful thing. He accepted Christ as Savior. And he said, you've done nothing wrong. Me and this other guy, we have done things wrong. But he said, you've done nothing wrong. What he was saying is, I know I've sinned, but I want forgiveness of my sin. And Jesus, he told Jesus to remember him, and Jesus said, today you will be with me in paradise. See what they're talking about? Jesus knew that before that day was over, he was going to die. And the other guy died with him. And when Jesus died, he went and got the keys of death hell, and the grave. And all the people in the Old Testament, he brought to heaven with him when he came. You know, all this was going on while he was in the tomb. You know, see, it's all happened. All the people in the Old Testament have been waiting for Jesus to die. Because in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 4, it says, let me read it here. For it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away our sins. See, every year on Passover, they would kill a lamb, a bull, and a goat, and the blood, they take that blood and pour it on the altar. Jesus, when he came, see, that it's like Derek said. It's kind of like when you owe a loan and you make a payment on it. But when Jesus died, it was paid in full. I like the way Derek says it, because that's exactly the way it is. All that other stuff then was all the blood from the goats and the lambs just made a payment. But when Jesus died, it was paid in full, because they couldn't pay for our sins. It takes the blood of a righteous man. And Jesus was the only man who could do it. Let me see where we're at. And his mother, Jesus' mother said to the servants, whatever he says, do it. I didn't realize this, so I got studying this, but this is the last recorded word of Mary in the Bible. And you think about what she said. That's a good thing for us to live our life by. Whatever he says, do it. She knew Jesus had the power to do that. Jesus did it. He told them. I think it's an amazing part of it. It says there were 6 water pots of stone. You got to understand, these water pots were they were made of stone, because that was for a reason. The Jewish customs were you had to be. The water had to come out of stone, because for ceremonial cleansing. And these were water pots. They were 20 gallon or 30 gallon, depending what kind of pots they were. But we know they were that big. You take 20 gallon of wine, that's a lot of wine. And it says right here, they filled them up to the rim. Man, I tell you, this right here really spoke to me, because I ain't even figured out why, what the significance of it is. I wish somebody would tell me if they know. But there's something to filling it up to the rim. It wasn't half full, it wasn't 3/4 full. But each pot was filled up to the rim. But, man, there's a lot here. And Jesus said, fill the water pots up with water, and he filled them up to the rim. And he said unto them, draw out now. And he said, bring it to the governor of the feast. We had a wedding in our church. Gail back there was was the coordinator of it. The governor of the feast coordinated the wedding. I tell you, there's something pretty neat right here. Because the servants knew, the disciples knew, Mary knew, but the bride and the groom and the guy who was over the wedding, he didn't know that they made the wine. I tell you what, that made me think about something. You got to have a servant attitude and a servant mindset to know what's going on. If you don't, you'll miss the miracles of Jesus. We need to think about our own life. I wonder how many times God has done a miracle, and we didn't know what was going on, and we missed it. I know there's been times when I've had a flat tire or something delayed me. You all know I'm always late. But it might be for a purpose. God might be working a miracle. But this really taught me a lesson right here. You know, the most powerful thing the servants knew, and the people who were honored at the wedding feast, they didn't know. They didn't have a clue what was going on. Well, then, when they fed this guy the wine, he said, every man in the beginning does set forth good wine, and when a man is well drunk, then they bring him the worst wine. But thou hast kept the good wine until now. I told Derek about this. I've been talking about this because I've had this on my mind for weeks. You know, it makes the groom what started out to be an embarrassing thing, because it was quite an embarrassment when you could be, it's like you wasn't going to be able to provide for your wife if you didn't have enough wine. You didn't want to run out of wine. But they ran out of wine. And Jesus, they didn't know they was out of wine. And Jesus turned the water into wine, 120 gallon of wine. Made a plenty of wine. And what started out to be an embarrassment for that guy turned out to be the guy putting on the wedding. He thought he was going to be a grape provider. You know, that's the way Jesus is. He takes away our shame and turns it into our glory.
Amen.
Derek always has a saying. He said this to me many times. He takes our message and makes it our mission. And that's kind of what Jesus does. Takes our mess and makes it a mission. See, this guy was supposed to be a provider for his family. And he was being judged as to what kind of provider he's going to be. But what turned out, this guy, he seemed like the ultimate provider, because the longer you got into it, the better it was. Everybody, once you get a little bit tipsy where you didn't have as good a taste buds, and gave you the best wine last. But he gave the best, not the best wine first, but he gave the best wine last. I tell you what, I missed so many years. What a great miracle this was. I thought, man, Jesus pretty much wasted his time on the first miracle. But I didn't realize. See, Jesus, he's always teaching. He's the greatest teacher ever was. But I was too dumb to get it. See, what happened? He made a covenant in the Old Testament. And then when he came along, he made a new covenant. And the new was better than the old was. Jesus did so much that the Jews would know, but they still missed it. He made it very plain that the new covenant was better than the old covenant. It's kind of like that guy who was governor of the peace. He said, new wine's better than old wine was. You know, you think about it. I mean, God made the covenant with us. But Jesus, when he came, he brought along a new covenant. I missed the whole story of the feast right there. You know, it's better than the last one was. I'd hate to be killing goats and lambs and sheep to make my... Can you imagine New York City right now, they had to kill lambs and goats? Man, it'd be stinking. It'd be flies blowing everywhere. You think the virus is bad. It's been awful up there. many people there is. Something hit me when I was studying for this. You know, Jesus, when he died on the cross, you know, in the old covenant, when they sacrificed an animal, they would take it outside the gate. It says that Leviticus 4, I think, talks about it. Leviticus 4, 10 through 12, I think it talks about it. Take the animal outside the gate when you kill it, and then take the blood inside the temple and sprinkle it on all the sacrificial instruments. You think about Jesus. When he died, they took him outside the gate. They took him to a hill called Golgotha to die. He wasn't crucified in the temple. He was outside the city. I tell you what, when you study this, Christ is so much that the Jews would know. And they missed it. It's kind of like me in the wedding feast. They missed it. I don't know why I couldn't see it, but finally God opened my eyes to where I realized what a miracle this was. Well, I just had this on my mind, and I'm glad we all came to listen. I'm glad you listened out there, because this was important to me. I know I don't talk good. I appreciate you all giving me the opportunity. Tim, would you close us in prayer?
Yeah. Father, we do love you. We praise you. We glorify your name, Lord. And Father, I just thank you for Ricky, Lord, coming this morning. Father, Lord, just to come and proclaim the name of Jesus, Lord. And Father, we thank you for Lord Easter, Father, that, Lord, you God, I just praise you, Father, because I'm the most unworthy person that you could have went to the cross for, Lord. And God, you conquered death today, Lord. And like Ricky said, you was done out of the tomb, Father. Of course, you went to appear to the disciples today, Lord. And God, we just praise you. We just praise you. Jesus, I just praise you. And Lord, I just pray that today, Lord, as our time has slowed down with this virus going on, Father, Lord, it's clear to me, Father, if we're not reading our Bible more and praying more, Lord, if we're not doing it now, we ain't ever going to do it. We're never going to do it, Lord. And Father, I just praise this virus is going on, Lord, that we draw closer to you. And Lord, I do. I pray for President Trump, Lord, and I just pray, Father, that, Lord, he does. He's got the toughest decision he'll ever have to make in his life. But Father, I pray he leans on you in prayer, Father, because, Lord, you have the ultimate answer. And Lord, I just pray your anointing on him, Father. And Lord, I just pray for all the governors in the states, Father. And Lord, I just pray that, that your hand be upon them, Father. I don't agree with a lot of them, Father, but Lord, I'm glad you got it, and I don't. And Father, I just pray your anointing on them and wisdom for them. Lord, we love you and we praise you. We thank you, Father. I do. I thank you. I don't know a lot about it, but I love technology now, Lord, because, Father, more people are watching than would probably be in the church pews, Father. And, Lord, I know we have the most captive audience right now, Lord, that we've ever had in our life. And my question today is us as Christians, Father, me being first in line, Lord, what am I doing with it? Am I trying to proclaim your name? Am I trying to lead others to Christ, Father? Because, Lord, we're to be your hands and feet. And I know that, Father. Lord, I just pray your blessings on each one today, Lord. I just pray your anointing on, Lord, the people that get together with their families or whatever they do, Lord. I just pray that Jesus' name is glorified today. We love you and praise you.